Today on Slopestyle TV, we head to the biggest ski resort in North America, Whistler Blackcomb, for 5 days of riding. Located 125 kilometers north of Vancouver, BC, the resort is divided into two mountains. Whistler Mountain has an elevation of 7,160 feet with a total vertical drop of 5,020 feet. Whistler is serviced by a total of 20 lifts, including the peak-to-peak gondola connecting it with Blackcomb Mountain to the north. Blackcomb Mountain has a higher vertical at 5,133 feet and is serviced by 17 lifts, as well as the end station for the peak-to-peak gondola. In this episode, we'll pick up some snowboarding tips from JP.
Little movements from edge to edge, keep myself centered.
Learn the history of the mountain from the Whistler Museum.
Up until the early 20th century, it was a pretty remote corner of British Columbia.
We'll ski with Canadian halfpipe champion rider Keltie Hansen. And later, we'll duck the rope heading out of bounds with Extreme Backcountry Clinics for some huge powder lines. Stay tuned, it's Slopestyle TV coming up.
We're in the back of the truck, we're just dropping off some gear. Getting ready for a big night out of the town.
So here we have our Whistler Blackcomb trail map, and I'm going to be showcasing some of the wonder routes here on Whistler Blackcomb. They were hand-picked to showcase some of the best that Whistler and Blackcomb have to offer, and they're to help guests navigate the massive amount of terrain that we have, even if they've never been here before. We're going to start with some of the steeps route by heading up Peak Express here on Whistler. going right off the chair and into Whistler Bowl. We're going to have some nice steep terrain there, heading right a bit towards Shale Slope off of this ridge here, and down into Franz's Meadow. From there, we can start heading into some nice, awesome powder stashes that we'll find towards Wildcard or Jimmy's Joker, and even those trees around there. Anywhere you go around here, we'll find some powder. Heading up Red Chair, we're going to go over to another powder stash, which is Ratfink, right of the Emerald Green Chair. Peek to peek over to Blackcomb for the rest of the day, and we're going to ride on over to Seventh Heaven. We're going to go left off the chair, go down Couloir Extreme, which is to showcase some of the steeps that we have on Blackcomb. And from there, we can link into some of the powder stash under Jersey Cream Chair, over here into Blowdown, Staircase, and the Bite. Those trees are awesome for powder. A lot of the wind tends to blow this way across the mountain and settle snow in there. And that'll kind of wrap up our afternoon.
We're just getting fitted for boots and gear here. We're going to go out with Extreme Backcountry Clinics and see what's happening around Whistler Blackcomb. Yeah, he's the earth child. Yeah, check it. I'm like a simile, cause I compare to everything with emphasis. Right with simply squaring out my synthesis. The synthesizer the way some pencil sits. You just stenciled in as I really mention this.
So where are we and where are we headed here? We're going that way. To the white, you can see nothing else. School, welcome to detention, kids. I just bent the rules with imagining my parentheses. You must be into this if you made it thus far. You don't have to take it. I think we climbed about 40 minutes on this first climb.
Excited. Very excited to ski.
Downtown music, baby.
Downtown music on the beat.
Hey, JP Falk here on Whistler Blackcomb with Slopestyle TV. This is your pro tip of the day for riding fast called pressure early, edge early. So for this tip of riding fast, what we're gonna be doing is putting our board on edge early in our turn and applying pressure as early as possible as we go through the turn. One thing we wanna focus on is not letting that pressure build as the board points downhill, as that will cause our edge to chatter out. To bring our board on edge early, we want to move our whole body across the board laterally to create a nice high edge angle, like we're exposing the base of our snowboard uphill. As we apply pressure, we're using our hips and knees to push on our board, and
and we're gonna hold that pressure throughout the turn. This is gonna help you go really fast. So you wanna set early on our edge and push, and push, push, push. Early edging, early pressure. So that's our pro tip on Slopestyle TV. We're here at Blackcomb Mountain with JP Falk. Thank you for watching.
Hi, my name is Matt Walker. We're down at Sports Traders today doing a little segment for Slopestyle TV. Today we're going to be talking about which way the industry is going for skis and ski shapes. Today we're going to be looking at skis that have rocker, which is early rise. This can be in the tip and the tail, versus skis that are traditional camber. No early rise, just your traditional tip and tail. A ski like this here, the Bonafide from Blizzard, rocker in the tip, a little bit of rocker in the tail, and underfoot here we're looking at 89 underfoot. So very happy whether it's in the fresh or if you're on the steep cruisers going fast. Really fun ski. Yeah, some skis that are working both technologies, such as the Inland Amphibio. The Inland Amphibio is a left and right ski. The inside edge on this ski is traditional camber with a rocker on the outside tip edge, so it sits like this. Very quick and easy turning with a little bit of flotation when you do go into the fresh snow. So when we're talking about rocker, this is the rocker here. You can see how much it separates, and your ski edge actually starts down here nice and low. That's about it for different sizes and shapes. We have tons of different brands down here. Come down and take a look. Everything from beginner to advanced skiers.
Coming up next on Slopestyle TV, we ride around the mountain with Canadian halfpipe champion Keltie Hansen, and then we'll learn a little bit more about the history of Whistler Blackcomb. Stay tuned.
Hi, I'm Keltie Hansen and we're here at Whistler Blackcomb and I'm on the National Halfpipe Skiing Team. I've been a competitive skier for probably about 7 years now. Really it was my family that fell in love with skiing first, and then I was dragged along for the ride probably since I was about 3 years old, so I really just grew up with it, and the more I did it, the more I loved it. Some of my major accomplishments would be podiuming, getting third at World Championships. I believe that was in 2011. And then I also, in that same year, won the AFP Championships at the end of the year. It's usually pretty busy, but we get to travel all over to the world. This year we get to go to a test event in Russia, and I love going new places, so it's really great if you like that lifestyle.
Actually, I do attend university. I go to Quest University in Squamish. I really love going to school, and I think it's still really important to concentrate on that while I'm doing my ski career. I was thinking about law school after skiing, but again, that could change. I definitely think that I ski more days than I don't ski, but I never keep track of how many I actually ski, so I should probably start counting that.
We're about halfway down the park and I'm scoping out this jump. I'm a little sore from my training session this morning, so I'm just gonna straight air and see how it goes.
Well, my team is definitely right now my main social life. We're really close. Two of my best friends are on the team, Megan Gunning and Roz Greenwald, so we spend so much time together. But I also have friends back at home that I like to keep in touch with, and I Skype with sometimes when I'm on the road. It's really important to have sponsors. I mean, they help you out like every day in your skiing. If it weren't for my sponsors, I wouldn't be able to do what I do. Columbia is one of my main sponsors, and they help me out with my outerwear and everything, and it keeps me warm and dry while I'm on the hill. My other ones are Smith Optics for goggles and helmets, and Atomic Skis for boots, poles, and skis.
Hey, thanks for skiing with me today, but I gotta go to the gym now and I'll catch you later.
Hi, I'm Kevin from the Victoria Athletic Club, and we're here with Slopestyle TV. Today we're going to look at some ways that you can get in shape before you hit the slopes this season, and we're going to start with warm-ups. Simple stuff, doesn't have to be anything technical. Something as simple as knees up, get the hip flexors warmed up, open up the glutes. You can add a little bit of a pull across to that, so as you bring the knee up, you pull it across. This is going to loosen up the glutes. It's going to warm up the quads too. Not the most glamorous part of the workout, but very, very important. Another thing we want to do when we warm up for skiing and snowboarding is trunk rotations. We want to get the spine flexed and moving. Little squats, of course. We're squatting a lot when we're on the slopes doing skiing or snowboarding. So you can start with just little squats, just something small, and then you can add those, add some depth to those squats as you go. The other thing you can do is you can add some knees up to those. We're never standing really just on one foot or both feet when we're skiing or snowboarding, so we want to switch our weight from side to side. The other thing you can do too is you can just, when you're standing in a lineup, move your hips from side to side, get everything loosened up. It might look like you're dancing, but that's all right. You got your earbuds in. You're having fun on the slopes. There we go.
Looking for the museum, which way should I be going?
For the museum, you're going to take the steps, it's on Main Street.
Hi, I'm Jeff Slack, I'm the Programs Manager at the Whistler Museum, and I'm here to tell you about the history of Whistler. So the Whistler Valley was a common trade route between First Nations people on the coast and the interior for thousands of years. But up until the early 20th century, it was a pretty remote corner of British Columbia. That all changed in 1914 when the railway came through, linking Squamish to the interior. And that same year, Rainbow Lodge was opened up. That was the first kind of tourist destination in the valley. It was a fishing lodge primarily and brought summer traffic from Vancouver and elsewhere. And that led to the development of a community in the Whistler Valley, oriented around summer tourism. They went hiking in the mountains, but it got a lot quieter in the winter. There was skiing. The first person to ski Whistler Mountain was actually in 1937, but skiing didn't really arrive in the Whistler Valley for good until the 1960s. So skiing came to the Whistler area in the 1960s when a group of Vancouver businessmen were inspired by the Squaw Valley Olympics and decided that they wanted to bring the Olympics to British Columbia. So they searched through the BC Mountains and decided upon what was known on government maps as London Mountain, but was always known locally as Whistler Mountain, as their preferred ski resort and Olympic venue. So in the early 1960s, they began organizing to develop the hill and to bring the Olympics, but at that point, the area still had no road access, no electricity, and no central plumbing, so it was not chosen, not surprisingly, for the Olympics, but it was, however, it was enough to get them started, and they developed the ski area, and Whistler Mountain opened in January of 1966. It was an instant hit. It was immediately the highest vertical of a ski resort in North America, and it blossomed from there. It became an extremely popular ski destination, so much so that in the 1970s, the municipal government was built and plans to develop Blackcomb began. So in 1980, there was Blackcomb opening, there was the new Whistler Village that served both mountains, and it was really through the 80s that Whistler and Blackcomb together brought this valley into, as it made it a global destination for skiing. And that set it on the trajectory to where it is today. And through this period, multiple ski Olympic bids kept being made. They were unsuccessful, but each time they failed, it prompted them to the local developers to develop the area more, and that culminated in the 2010 games that happened just a few years ago.
Coming up next on Slopestyle TV, we learn how not to burn the toast with a cruiser snowboard lesson from JP. More Slopestyle TV from Whistler Blackcomb after the break.
The Zone at 91.3 Modern Rock.
Hey, I'm JP Falk here on Whistler Blackcomb with your cruiser tip of the day. It's called Toaster. So what we're doing today is we're gonna stand like we're in a giant toaster slot. So when we're standing on our snowboard, we don't wanna be leaning too far on either side or out of position in any way, or else we're gonna get burned by the sides. We wanna imagine we're standing nice in our toaster with flex knees. So we don't want to find ourselves in any position where our butt's sticking out like this. We don't want to be counter-rotated like this. And we don't want to end up super heavy on one foot. We want to stay nice and centered in the toaster. We don't want to get burned. So here I am, nice and centered in the toaster. I'm riding and I'm just moving little movements from edge to edge to keep myself centered. If I move too far, I'm going to get burned. So we want to stay nice and centered in our toaster. So that was our cruiser tip of the day, called Toast. Just keeping our body nice and aligned and balanced on our snowboard. I'm JP Falk with Slopestyle TV, and we're here on Whistler Blackcomb.
Accommodation for the Slopestyle crew while in Whistler provided by Evolution at Creekside. Evolution is uniquely designed and furnished to give you the best of both worlds. Open floor plans create versatile living spaces perfect for both relaxing with your family and entertaining your friends. Evolution is consistently ranked in the top 10 hotels to stay at while visiting Whistler on TripAdvisor.com. For more information, visit evolutionwhistler.com.
For sure. All right, Kyle, what's happening?
Well, just got out from an epic day of skiing. So we're down here at Creekside, we're at Evolution, and they provided us with a really nice barbecue.
This is sweet.
Hot dogs roasted.